nations in the world. I'm a cowboy poet who likes to talk, and a preacher who just likes to talk. And guess what? I have a mic. Well, good morning. It's 10 o'clock on another bright, beautiful, sunny Sunday morning. It's raining back home. But they said it's only supposed to rain till 9 a.m. our back home time, so 8 a.m. this time, so it'll probably stop about 3. That's the normal situation. I got home last night after the jam, and I had a text message from my wife. She went, "We have a phenomenon in Manitoba. It's called the wedding social." And what the wedding social is, it's a party for the engaged couple. They're getting married. It's a fundraising party. So they charge $10 a ticket or so to get in. And then at the social, you know, they have the banquet tables, and then they'll have little snacks on the banquet tables, and they have a DJ. There's a bar, and the bar is, you know, it's a cash bar and stuff. And they keep the prices lower. But then they have all these prizes that you can, you just buy, you know, like we had here, you buy X amount of tickets. And all these prizes are donated. I think the social last night had like 36 of these prizes. And then they get grand prizes. So grand prize could be a 55-inch TV. Or it could be a smoker, like a big smoker barbecue. So good ones. And that normally the family or the wedding party donates that. So my wife went to one of these socials last night for a good friend of ours. And the pictures and all the text was, "La, la, 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 I won, you didn't." And that's all it was. And she showed me she won two big packages. Like, she won a microwave because we only have 3, so now we've got 4. You know, she gets, and my wife is hilarious because she has worked very hard in her life to get to where she is. And she's now in a situation, if she goes there and she spends $100 on those tickets, to her it's just a $100 donation to the couple. She never worries about it, but she is superstitious because she won't let me touch the tickets. Because she says I'm bad luck when it comes to socials, hence why I didn't win anything here last night. But then I also look at it and kind of reminds me of a little story. There's a fella, he comes home from church on Sunday, a little bit depressed, and he looks up and he says, "God, why do you forsake me?" He says, "I've worked so hard," he says, "but I have nothing. I really need to win the lottery. Why won't you help me win the lottery?" Well, lottery draw day comes up, and he doesn't win the lottery again. And then after church, he's praying in church, but after church, he figures his own alone time, goes, "God, you forsake me one more time. Why won't you help me win the lottery? I really need that money." Well, this goes on for 4 weeks. And after the 4th week, he's just on his knees, just pleading. He goes, "God, help me. Why won't you let me win the lottery? I really need the money." And then in a big booming voice, God says, "At least buy a ticket." And on that, good morning, everyone, and welcome to Cowboy Church. See, no laughing in church. Church is now in session. No laughing. And isn't it, like I said, it's a wonderful day in Shoshone. It's a great day to be here. It's a great day to be alive. We have some entertainment, so you're not going to have to put up with me the entire time. So we're going to do it a little bit like a normal session. I'm going to start off with a little simple prayer and a poem. And then Prairie Winds will come up and share. And then our friend Lynn Kopelke will come up and share. And we'll do that a couple times. And then I have a little message at the end I'd like to share with you. So if I can ask, you don't have to stand up, but please, gentlemen who have hats, please remove your hats. We'll just start off with a quick little poem. A quick little prayer. Lord, good morning. And thank you for allowing us to wake up this morning and experience another day to celebrate your word and celebrate all the blessings you have bestowed upon us. Thank you for allowing us to live in a country where we can still meet together and celebrate you and celebrate our faith and everything that was done for us at the cross. I'd like to ask that you keep the entertainers and the guests and the visitors who have had to travel early, please keep them safe in your loving arms. And please bless us in this meeting as we celebrate your great blessings and celebrate your word together. And in Jesus' name, amen. I want to share just a little quick poem. Last year, and everybody here knows Thatch, and they've all seen Thatch, and I love that. I can't get it. You know, there's not just him, all the other young entertainers. It's bad enough they're all so cute. Why do they all have to be so good? That's another blessing. You know, God bestows blessings on good people. Well, last year, Thatch and I were billeted at the same house. And Saturday night, he came and shared with me. We were sitting around, his dad and I were sitting around talking. And he came, and he was very excited. He said, "Jeff, look at this picture I found." And it was a picture he found on the internet or had been shared on Facebook or something. And what it was, there was it looked like a bull rider who was down on the ground. There was a bull coming after him. And on the bull, it said sin. And standing in between them was Jesus. And he goes, "Let's write poems about this." Well, he's 12 years old. He performed his poem Sunday morning in church last year. Mine took a little bit longer. So I'd like to share it with you now. So this is the poem that I came up with from that picture. It's called Saved. I thought I was ready to go. I didn't expect that gate to blow. The force of the bull shook the ground. Eyes glowed blood red. Acted like it wanted me dead. Was almost deafened by the sound. I had trouble getting into my groove as that bull matched my every move as if it knew all my tricks. This fight became a major grind. I found myself one step behind and got caught with one of its kicks. Was one scared clown as it had knocked me down, and that bull was coming in for the kill. And in its eyes I could see the sins of my past staring at me, and up my spine I could feel a chill. Through my battered eyes I see a man's figure in front of me. His hand turned that bull aside. Last thing I saw was the bull withdraw. Was this when I died? I awoke with a scream. It was only a dream. And I knocked a book off the nightstand. What I saw was hard to ignore. It was my Bible on the floor. And it caught me completely offhand. Was open to Deuteronomy 31:6. And what it said, I did transfix. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or tremble at them. For the Lord your God is the one who gives you, who goes with you. He will not fail you or forsake you. It wasn't a dream after all. Jesus had saved me from a close call and will always be there to see me through. Down on my knees to pray, I thank Jesus for another day. He rescued me from my sins, so I will praise him even when life looks grim to help ensure the devil never wins. Thank you. And with that, I'm going to call on Prairie Wind to come and share with you. See, you don't remember the order from last night.
Left 25. Left. Today's NFL day, right?
It is Sunday. That's right.
Okay, so is today? Today is the day no one ignores the national anthem.
What?
That's my wish.
Unless you're that guy.
Oh, the guy that was being cut and got fined $50 million.
I hope he got fined. Out of work, maybe.
I just like to meet that guy.
What'd you do to this poor microphone? Yeah, that's better. Morning, folks. Hey. You're supposed to be over there.
I'll come move that one.
No, it's okay. He's.
I got it.
He's drawing Social Security now. Then I come to find out he's drawing more than I am.
Oh, yes.
Thank you. as he said, we go by prairie wind when the two of us are together, because we got tired of being calling two quarts and a pint, or or Joe and Little Joe, or the two J's, or the big guy and the little guy. Well, they started off with the white guy and the Indian. I says, that's already been taken.
or the guy with hair and the other guy.
Now I remember last night.
Sometimes we're called two hits and a miss.
Yeah, two hits and a miss, and we're still looking for the miss.
It has been and never was. Okay, let's get on with the show.
Other than that, this is my... Now, I found out here this weekend by the Panhandle Cowboys that it is politically incorrect. That's a big word for this cowboy, I'll tell you right now. Especially Sunday morning. Only had four cups of coffee. That we are not partners. We are not pards. We have to be something else. Well, that's what they said. And a guy comes and says, no, don't say you're partners because then they think you're together. And I says, really? Well, blank, 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 blank. Them. Anyway, I'm tired of political correctness. All right. I am a gay caballero. I am
happy.
A happy man. I am lighthearted. I ride my pony. I am fun. I like this. I sing. I play my little guitar. I sing my little songs. I'm a logger from Roseburg, Oregon. Anyhow, Little Joe McCutch has been with me for 10 years. Been a little over 10 years. And we are partners in music. I know when to start. He knows when to start. Where I leave off, he picks it up. I've been proud to... I loan him out. I haven't gotten paid for months.
I get paid weekly. Real weekly.
Real weekly. And I'm Coyote Joe. But together we are Prairie Wind. Thank you all for coming out this morning. And we're going to just do a few songs. I call them songs of praise. Cowboy style.
By the way, I had to turn this down because you can turn it up there now. I had too much power coming out.
Song called One Last Trail. Do us a lead in if you remember. That ain't it. These old cowboy bones are weary from years of hanging on to ornery coyote uses and memories long gone. I can barely hit the saddle when the morning cold prevails, and I've left the better parts of me on the many drives and trails. My thumbs are thrashed and throbbing, and my knees have long been gone. Crushed between fence and bucking colts when the work had to be done. But it's not that I am complaining, Lord, or wanting to turn tail, but I hear you calling for me, and I'd like one last trail. Give me one last trail. Grant me one last ride before I hang my spurs and saddle and cross that great divide. Let me see one more sunrise, hear one more
coyotes wail, praying one last sundown, riding one last trail. I've been blessed more than most, Lord, from the life I have to choose. I spend my time with high-rise walls on crowded avenues, but I don't want to hang it up. Said my body's getting frail. I've got long enough for one more day, and give me one last trail. Give me one last trail. Grant me one more ride before I hang my spurs and saddle and cross that last divide. Let me see one more sunrise, hear one more coyote's wail, praying one last sundown, riding one last trail. I can count the days I've tasted, near forgot when I was born. I forgot the names of all my partners, except this one mountain I'm on. Partners' names may often escape me, and my memory's getting frail, but I remember I'm a cowboy. Give me one last trail. Oh, give me one last trail. Grant me one last ride before I hang my spurs and saddle and cross that last divide. Let me see one more sunrise, hear one more coyote's wail, praying one last sundown, riding one last trail. Riding one last sundown, riding one last trail. Thank you. Let's get our filler back up here.
You unplugged? No, I'm not. I'm going to leave it plugged.
Leave it plugged.
Isn't that all we want? All we ever request, one last trail. One last time. One last chance. One thing I noticed when they were singing, I'm sorry, it struck me as amusing. Remember I said I was going to help Coyote Joe, and I moved the stand. I never realized I'm left-handed and left-legged and dominant, but I read on my right side. Because that's why I was standing like this, because I couldn't see it out of my left eye. If it was over here, I could have looked right at you and did my poem, because I could have seen the words. Anyway, I'm not going to bore you anymore with me. What I'm saying is my memory's still as good as it was yesterday. And I want, just before I call Mr. Lincoln Pelkey up, one other thing. I know last year I was here, I preached. I was very grateful. I loved it. I said I was a licensed pastor, which I was last year. This year I'm an ordained pastor. Yeah, my wife and I got ordained together. End of January this year, we finally all worked out that we could. We both had all our work done, and we finally connected. So we were in. We actually stayed in Fort Worth for a couple extra days, and we got ordained in Fort Worth, Texas, last end of January. So, with that, Mr. Len Kopelke.
He walks not in the ways of the wicked men.
Well, you don't hardly walk nowhere at all. Set him from his campfire to pull the picket pin. See, sunrise finds him horseback riding tall. He stands not in the way of sinners. He'd probably just run him over anyway. And he keeps to himself, rounds the veterans and the beginners, and he never seems to have too much to say. But he rejoiceth in the life that God has given him. Well, he will, when he figures what rejoiceth means. It's like the cottonwoods that thrive, down where the arroyo bends, always prospering on the banks of the stream. He sits not in the seat of scoffing men, because the saddle's an honest place to be. And he looks back on his trails, the places that he's been, and he wonders about the things he's yet to see. For he's seen nothing quite so righteous as a sunrise when it paints the farthest ridges of the blues. And he sings the praises of the eagle as she flies. He worships in his church that has no pews. Oh, he rejoiceth in the life that God has given him. And yeah, I think I know he knows exactly what that means. He is like the cottonwoods that thrive down where the arroyo bends, always prospering on the banks of that stream. It's the Cowboy Psalm, folks. Thank you.
Maybe you do get stuck with me more often. Well, I guess it's the same as me being the MC of a show. I'm not going to be tortling your gentle. I'm not your hostess with the mostest. He looked at me and said last night, he's got a beard. And I says, yeah, I got a goatee. So, you know, we can still be brothers of the facial hair. So I have another poem I'd like to share with you. It's funny, just in the last year and a half or so, I've noticed that almost all my writing seems to gear towards my faith. And even when we do poetry challenges sometimes. Somebody will post a picture and say, okay, go. And then within 24 hours, all these poems start rolling in. And I've even had one guy look at me and says, man, all you think about is God. And I send it back and says, well, what else is there? And I go, well, I never thought about it like that. I'm going, okay, so this one's called The Last Gate. And it's kind of funny because I guess I seem to think about as you pass on too, so. Yeah, the last gate. I don't remember that gate being there. I passed by this year every day, by this way, every day of the year. Was sure that I knew each gate on my land. Every inch of fence was put up by hand. Not like the others that I've installed. It had brass hinges. And on it, this was inscribed. John 14:6. Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. And it was all very prim. I opened the gate and rode straight through. The pasture looked familiar, but something was new. Grass was stirrup high. I was riding my best mare. The stream flowed freely, and all my friends were there. We're happy to see them. It's been many years. It was just beautiful, and I smiled through my tears. I had entered that last gate and went back home to live with my Lord, never again to roam. Thank you. Prairie Winds. You know, if I had little Joe playing with me, I could be up here for a long time too, you know.
That's why I was talking about that political correct thing.
I'm Canadian. We don't have political correct. We all got it. Well, I guess I can't say that. We do have Trudeau.
They got what? Trudeau? Yeah.
Yeah, you know, the yoga teacher, that guy.
You said you wanted to trade somebody for him, didn't you? Oh, all the stars that are going to leave our country once there's a new president. Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to leave this country, by golly. Well, you must not like it. Get the hell out of my country. Huh?
Yeah, be
Yeah, good.
Seems like all of our proudness is gone.
Yeah.
You know, it seems like all of our proudness is all gone now. It's just nobody's proud.
We don't want to get political here now.
No,
tell you
we
right
don't.
Now. Be arguing.
I just had to say that.
I know. Yeah.
I feel better then.
Like
thank
down
you.
On the nations, you know, they're saying, I think we got screwed. Yeah, but we're getting them back. We got the casino. Most of the songs we're singing today, well, that we're going to sing. I did a CD a couple years ago. It's called Songs of Faith. Worst 10 minutes of my life. No, I wasn't lost totally, but I was changed a little bit.
Wore out his knees.
In the shadow of the cross, I have finally found some peace. As I journey up this rocky road of life, it offers shelter and relief. Through the mountains and the valleys, it marks the way so I'm not lost. As I travel up this steep and narrow trail, in the shadow of the cross, in the shadow of the cross, that's where I lay my burdens down. And when the flood of doubt comes rolling in, it's my place for higher ground. God help me to remember that precious blood that stains the tree. God grant that I may never forget that precious blood was shed for me. Here's a little joke. The cross, oh, the healing power's there. Freedom from the pain that life may bring, there's only comfort and care. For a bright, mighty promise, it was there he paid the price. With the best that the Master had to give, in the shadow of the cross, in the shadow of the cross, that's where I lay my burdens down. And when the flood of doubt comes rolling in, it's my place for higher ground. God help me to remember that precious blood that stains the tree. God grant that I may never forget that precious blood was shed for me. In the shadow of the cross, it was all done for me. There you are. Thank you.
Would you like to hear another one right off the bat? All right, thank you. Let's do a little bit of my, Why Me, Lord. You know that one?
Everybody sing a lot.
I ask that question a lot. My mother started me on that, you know. I was walking down the street the other day, and I walked in front of this here church. And I looked up at that big old steeple up there and saw that cross. Sat down on the curb right in front there, and I asked myself, why me, Lord? What did I ever do to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do to deserve even one for the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it so. Help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I needed you so, help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Try me, Lord, if you think there's a way I can try to repay all I've taken from you. Well, maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Folks, if you know it, just sing it, okay? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it so. Help me, Jesus, I know what I am now that I know. Now that I know that I've needed you so, help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. All together, okay? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it so. Help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I've needed you so, help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Thank you, folks.
Thank you.
We'll be back up a little bit.
I got one more. Okay. That's perfect. You moved that to the right side there.
Isn't that true? I know who I am. Just a sinner saved by grace. I can't tell you. I was talking to a pastor outside this morning, and we're just talking about, and just like every morning when I wake up, first thing I do is I thank God for granting me another day. Everything else from there is gravy. We all face our struggles, and sometimes, and I was explaining to some people here today, I take 12 different painkillers a day. And I don't have a painkiller problem. They all work together to make sure I can walk and I can use my hands and I can turn my head sometimes. But I've had friends who question that and say, well, if God is real, if God is so good, how come you're in that kind of shape? I looked and said, I put myself in this shape. God didn't put me in this shape. I said, but God grants me the ability to wake up every morning. And they kind of look, they have no answer for that. I said, you know what? I says, tomorrow God could heal me and I could wake up pain-free and never have pain again the rest of my life. I says, or God can keep me in pain until I complete the job he has for me, and then he'll grant me peace and no pain. That might be the day that they put me into the ground, but if that is the day, then I have an eternity to rejoice in the pleasure and joy of his life. So if any of you know, I'm sure there's some of you stand there going, well, you're the hat guy, right? You say that poem about the hats? So if you've noticed, this is my fourth hat of the weekend. If you didn't notice, this is my fourth hat of the weekend. It is so funny because I was at one gathering, I wore the same hat all gathering. They asked me if I forgot the poem. And I said, no, I just didn't have enough room to pack. But I almost always be ready to give something else up to be able to bring a hat. You know, even if I'm flying, I have been known to fly with two hats on my head because I refuse to check it. But anyhow, maybe that's a problem I need to be praying about. I guess it could be worse. I know Carly Joe was laughing about political correctness. And you know, I don't like being political and stuff, but it is true. It seems to be getting so crazy. And I saw this post, and I'm not picking on Colin. I don't agree with what he did. I think it was disgusting. I think it was so disrespectful and he may have a problem with some of the stuff that's going on. Everybody has a problem with some of the stuff that's going on, and not only in the United States, in Canada, in the whole world. And yes, he does have the right, First Amendment has the right to freedom of speech and freedom of expression. But I think he's disrespecting the people who have fallen to give us the power and the right to have that right. So that's why I think it's disrespectful. I'm not even American. Like they mentioned, I can sing the Star Spangled Banner, and how many of you can sing O Canada? I'm not being rude, but it's the fact most of you don't spend half your year in Canada because it's real cold there half the year. That's why I spend half my year down here, you know. I just have to get it figured out because last year I spent most of the summer down in Texas and I was up in Canada. So I go, this doesn't work. You know, minus 50 is not the greatest thing in the world. So I'm going to share one more poem. Then Lynn's going to come up, and then Prairie Winds is going to come up and do one more song or maybe two more songs, and then I'll share the message with you. So this one is called On Bended Knee, and I think everybody can relate to it. I'm on bended knee when mending a fence, and branding this way only makes sense. Help him birth a calf in a winter snow, checking on crops and as winds start to blow, playing with a child close to your heart, holding someone's hand as things fall apart. But most importantly, when praying to the Lord, my soul opens up and my faith is restored. And with that, Lynn Kopelke.
I think that was the hard part for me, Joe, getting down. Yeah. When things are at their darkest, and a prayer is all you got, can feel mighty lonesome, sort of helpless and forgot. Whether it's flood, fire, famine, it's the worst 3 years in a row, so you pray to heaven. You hope like hell the answer didn't come too slow. Maybe it's a friend somewhere near or far away. You want to be there for him. You want to help. But really, all you can do is pray. You know, kind of a shame it takes things like this to get some of us to pray in. Maybe if we practiced more, we'd know better what needed saying. Well, the book says, don't be anxious. And I reckon it really is quite a lot to have his ear and his promise to hear when a prayer is all you got.
At least he can't say I'm not accommodating.
Okay, well, we know the party's over.
Now you know the true meaning of power of prayer.
I had a beer earlier and I started off with Gloria. I thought, well, God, something comes over me once in a while. I'm sorry.
Like I said, the power of prayer.
I have played music for over 53 years. I cowboyed for 35 while playing music because there was no money in music. There was no money in cowboying either. You put the two together. I was kind of like Little Joe, you know. Broke. Started off life as a churchgoer because my grandma and my mother insisted. They says, Little Joe, you're going to, by God, get yourself some education in the church. And I did. I was about 13. Then I started out with the hired hands and going out and gathering cattle and working fences and working all summer, and church went by the wayside, but we had every Sunday morning a meeting around the chuck wagon. Well, our chuck wagon was an old 37 Chev that had a lunch box in the back, and it was usually one of the girls would drive it out to the field or out wherever we was working, and we'd have lunch. But there was always a moment that somebody'd take his hat off and say, you know, we want to say something here, because not every morning somebody can get up and say, you know what we're going to do? We're going to be cowboys. And we got the freedom to say it, learn it, work it, breathe it. And we worshiped right out there in front of, well, God and nature, but not everybody else. There was nobody else out there. This is another one that's going to be coming out on the CD. I'm redoing that Songs of Faith CD because I wasn't really pleased with it. So it's a place where I worship. Place. Are you sure that's how it goes?
No.
Me either.
I was thinking of the other one. Uh-huh.
Is that, you were thinking of that other,
yes.
Other.
Uh-huh.
The other place.
Yes.
That's the bar.
Oh, the power of prayer.
Well, I thought we... Let's just turn the page on this. Maybe we'll do one of them that I wrote. Oh, no, let's do... That's it. You know it. I knew him. Yeah, that's why he's my partner over there. Oh, the stars
are the candles, and they light up the mountains. Mountains are altars of God. Oh, the place where I worship is the wide open spaces built by the hand of the Lord. There's a carpet of green and a sky blue roof above, and I'm welcome there alone or with the one I love. In your heart, take a good look. If you follow the good book, you'll find that your safe reward. Oh, the place where I worship is a wide open spaces built by the hand of the Lord. Here's little Joe. There's a carpet of green and a sky blue roof above, and I'm welcome there alone or with the one I love. In your heart, take a good look. If you follow the good book, you're sure to find your reward. Oh, the place where I worship is the wide open spaces built by the hands of the Lord. Built by the hands of the Lord. And there you are.
Thank you. Before Papa Matt gets back up here, I want to say a couple things and thank you. One, first, we'd like to thank him for coming up here and doing Sunday Cowboy Church with us, or just coming up and spreading the word. Second of all, is that little guy over that there module. He's our sound man. It's called Chris. He's done a fantastic job. He got just about as much sleep as we did.
Been a true warrior, that's true.
That's right.
Yes, we appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Today, we only have a few choice people from the committees that's put this show on. And our hearts go out in a great big thank you, because if they didn't put it on and work hard all year, I mean, this morning we're at the table and we're already having a kind of a prelim meeting. What are we going to do next year? Anyway, thank you, Payson. Claudia isn't here. I see, oh, Christ. Yeah, that's
Rust.
Thank you.
Rusty.
I've only known him a short time, you know, 20-some years. I mean, thank you, Rusty, for sitting in. And then I see Lynn down there. She's kind of a cute little gal. And,
there you I say go. That's all of them.
Okay, back. But that's what I want to say. Thank you. And if it isn't for you folks, we don't exist.
Yes.
So thank you very much.
God bless you.
Coyote Joe, Little Joe, Lynn Kopelke. But last year was my first year here, and I was greatly honored when Claudia asked me if I would host and share a little bit on the Cowboy Church. And I knew a couple people that were coming here. Like, I had met Coyote Joe and Little Joe before. I knew Lynn, who came last year as a spectator and was recruited to come and help. But I didn't know everybody. But I know everybody, when I was my set, I just asked people, they all said yes. And that's what I've seen all weekend. And you know what, that's kind of our two cultures go together, the cowboy culture and the Western entertainment culture. We're not in competition with each other. We all may have merchandise to sell, but we're not competing against each other going, buy mine, not theirs, buy mine, but not theirs. We're there for each other. I've seen musicians, they break a string, somebody else, they don't even know, hands them a string, here you go. Not expecting repayment, not worrying about it. And isn't that what being a servant of Christ is? You find out who your true friends are when they can't, when you can no longer do anything for them. Because they're still there. They're still being your friends. So I had planned, and when Little Joe said they pray at the bar, I did a rodeo this spring. I did a cowboy church. They told me I had to be done by 12:45 because the bar opened at 1. And I was standing just in front of the bar. But the biggest thing and the most amazing thing to me was there was a lot of competitors riding around the arena, which they do before a rodeo. A lot of the timed event people, they like to warm their horses up and everything else. And when I started, one person stood their horse. By the time I was done, there was about 20 people on horseback and from the arena. They'd all stopped riding and stood there. You know, and I found that very powerful because for some of those guys and girls, they travel all summer. And the only time they'll ever have a chance to hear the word of the Lord is at a rodeo. And I think it's very important that we continue to support that and request that if you're a rodeo person or you're having gatherings, request that they have a cowboy church Sunday morning. Because sometimes that's the only time these people will ever hear the word of the Lord. And I think it's very important. So I had the sermon or the little message I shared there. I figured, it's a perfect one to share here. And then last week, God decided something different. I'm gathering it as God because I couldn't have come up with the idea on my own. I was walking on a treadmill. And all of a sudden, this phrase that I had heard in a little cowboy church in Axel, Texas in January came to my head and goes, what about that phrase, dummy? I was like, I forgot about it. Oh, yeah, I know. Now it's back. And the phrase is there going to be somebody in heaven because of you? Pretty simple phrase, right? But when you think about it, I gave my life to Christ years ago. I kind of had I mentioned it yesterday. I'd been dabbling in Christianity. I was born, baptized, confirmed Anglican. I was an altar boy in a high Anglican church. At 14 years old, I was standing at the front of the church going, what are they saying? Because the services were mostly in Latin. I didn't understand a thing that was being said, so I turned around and I walked away from the church. And I had dabbled going to cowboy church a few years earlier than this. And the first time I ever went to cowboy church, I was so hungover I couldn't even see. I was sure I would have to slit my throat to clear my eyes from being red. That's how red they were. That's how sick I was. But something made me get up that morning and go to church. And I didn't give my life back to Christ that day. But something in my head just stuck with me. And then when that arena, when they thought I had been killed and they were worried and I got up and brushed myself off and I didn't even have a concussion, I realized God had kept me here for a reason and I just went, I'm yours, man. I tried making it on my own and you saw what happened there. You know, I have artificial knees. I have reconstructed shoulders. I have reconstructed infused ankles. I have reconstructed face. I am a delight going through metal detectors at airports. I don't wear metal. I'm sure they want me to go through that walkabout naked. Because they go, there's nobody can have that much metal in their body. But yeah, I do. And that was how most of that stuff happened before I surrendered myself. So anyhow, that word came. But I looked at it and says, have I been a closet Christian? Am I ashamed to admit my faith to my friends or for them to even know that I am a Christian? How many of you have sat in a church pew? You declare your faith in the church pew. You sing the songs. You put your money, your tithe in, if the church that you go to has a tithe. But then when you go in the store right after church or a restaurant right after church and you meet somebody you know who isn't a believer, and you make up a story of where you were instead of just saying, I was at church. Who's ever done that? I have. When I was a new Christian again, I did it because I was ashamed. I wear a cross 24/7. I actually have the name of my ministry tattooed to my arm in a cross. And there is some debate that Christians shouldn't have tattoos and stuff, but I looked at it and says, the one I follow was so scarred. And he was scarred because of our sins. Me declaring my faith on my body is the least, in my thought, is the least I could do. I don't know if I could pierce my hands for somebody else. I made a decision a long time ago when I enlisted in the military, I could die for somebody else. But could I just pierce my hands for somebody else? For something I had nothing to do with? So I wondered that. I also used to wear a cross all the time. I have a cross around my neck. It's not out now, but every time I'm wearing a t-shirt without button up, it's highly visible. Years ago, when I was in church or at home, it would be highly visible. But as soon as I walked out the door, I tucked it into my shirt. Afraid if I met somebody who wasn't a believer, how would I react? And I was thinking, that kind of goes about against what God says. Psalm 93:3, declare his glory among the heathen, his wonders among all people. Our instruction, that's pretty clear, right? Declare his glory among the heathen and his wonders among all people. He didn't say sit in a church with other believers. You're preaching to the choir there. We're all believers, or we all pretend to be believers. We all declare our faith. Go out and declare your faith. Be loud, be proud. And it's unfortunate when talking about political correctness, it's unfortunate that people in North America now are being looked at for doing that. And I'm going to use an NFL thing for it. They say, if this is okay, Colin sitting during the national anthem because he's expressing his freedom of expression, if you're okay with that, but so many people looked at Tim Tebow when he bowed and when he knelt down to pray, and they say that wasn't okay, that's the problem. Because he was not afraid to declare, and everybody was afraid because he was. There's a problem there. It says, our instructions can't be much clearer, says Matthew 5:16. Our instructions can't be much clearer. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Not sit in the pews and just wait, hold on. I'm good, but I don't want to know. And then a few years ago, almost when I got killed there, I decided it was enough. I can't go around being a closet Christian. What am I afraid of? I knew when I gave my life to Christ that I was going to may lose some people in my life, and I have. But then I also realized those people weren't really there for me in the first place. If they truly loved me and truly cared about me, they would still truly love and care about me because I was a Christian. So some of them walked away. I'm very happy to say some of them are coming back because now they're seeking guidance. They've lost their way. And now they're asking for help. I can't help them. I'm a tour guide. Only he can help them. But I can help them get there. I can put them in the right path. I can give them the tools that work for me. And a lot of them are now looking at it going, how my life is totally different. I'm not afraid. What's there to be afraid of? You know, I have all eternity, man. I don't need to be afraid. And Colossians 4:2-6 offers us a list of ways of celebrating God's blessings. Continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving. Withdraw with all praying also for us that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds. Don't be afraid. Talk. Share. What are they going to do? They're not going to punch you. Well, they might. They may just say no and turn around. If they do, whose loss? Is that your loss? It's their loss because they don't understand the eternity of life. 4, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom towards them that are without, redeeming the time. And let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. Your plan, your life plan, your life journey. Where were you? Never forget where you were before. Who wants to go back to their life before they gave it to Christ? Anybody want to go back? You know, I look at it, go, oh, yeah, well, I had lots of money. Had. Oh, yeah, I had. Had. What do you have? I have eternal life. Your deal. Now, the secret to sharing God's life fearlessly. There is a plan. It says, share Jesus without fear, God's guidance. You guys want to be able to share Jesus without fear? Those who don't? Isn't that what we're supposed to do? Go out and make disciples of all, in all corners of the earth? Not keep all the joy to yourself. Blessed is the man who gives everything away. You know, I have a different philosophy now. When I was younger, money meant so much to me. I wanted. I needed. What did I need it for? I just spent it. Oh, it felt good to spend it. And then I had a whole bunch of stuff. And then I needed a bigger place for my stuff. Now I'm selling like George Carlin. But at the end of the day, it was just stuff. I lost most of my stuff. What I didn't lose, I gave most of the rest away. I go on mission trips with 14 days worth of clothes. I come back with the clothes I have on my back because I leave it all there. Almost all of it is stuff I've maybe worn once. Some of it is stuff I've never worn. Shoes, everything. My wife thought I was nuts. She does it worse than I do now. Give it away. Share. Some people think if they share their faith in Jesus Christ is going to bring guilt and fear to them. You just have to look no further than the first book of the New Testament to see that we are commanded to share God's good news with others. Matthew 28, 19 and 20 says, therefore go forth and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of age. Does it say I'm with you until you believe? Does it say I'm with you until your time on earth passes? No. I am with you until the very end of age. He was with us before we were even thoughts, before our parents, our grandparents, our great-grandparents, before time existed, he was with us. He already knew every one of us. He knew what his plan for us was, and he gave us the opportunities to find it out. Some of us took a long time, man, and some of us may never find it out. We may search and search and search. My mother died at 55 years old. My friends go, if God's so good, why did your mother die so young? I says, her job on earth was done. My mom didn't die. God called her home. Because her whole life, she lived for him. My father lived longer. My father had 3 types of cancer, beat all 3. My father had a triple bypass, beat that. My father was at his house, smiling, talking, laughing, had a heart attack and died right there. The last moment of my father's life was he was laughing because he knew. Didn't matter what the joke was, he knew. His time's done. He's going home. Because he gave his life to Christ. So he wasn't afraid. Don't be afraid. Go out and make these things. Now, starting a discussion about spirituality is also a big barrier in sharing your faith. Most people won't talk about it because they're afraid of what somebody's going to say. I can be afraid. I used to be afraid when I got on stage what people were going to think of me. Oh, are they going to like what I do? Are they going to hate what I do? Are they going to, oh, am I wearing the right clothes? Look, if you notice, it's all blue. Okay, it's the only clean stuff I had left. It just happened to color coordinate, right? But I used to worry about that. I was a high school teacher. My kids didn't care what I wore. Most of them didn't even know I was in the class. They just go, wah. I felt like Charlie Brown. Like, wah, 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 wah. But I worried about that. I don't worry about that anymore. When I come up here, or anytime I talk in front of anybody, when I share God's word, I share what I believe with all my heart and soul the Holy Spirit has put on my heart to share with you. How much better is that? It's not my job to totally understand everything God does, because when I look up just at my life, man, I kind of, what were you thinking? Some mornings I wake up going, oh, I'm still here. Other days I wake up going, ah, I'm still here. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. You know what, this is kind of a little bit longer. I'm just trying to get the point across that we're not meant to be closet Christians. We're meant to be proud. Be proud of your faith. Be proud that you have given your life over to Jesus, and you know when your job is done here on earth, you have an eternal life, and those who you love and that have shared that walk with you, if they have passed before you, will be there waiting for you. That's all it is. And you will have people walk away from you in your life because you declare to be Christian, because you declare. But were those people really that important? I've had family turn away. Maybe not my brothers and sisters. Well, my younger brother and I don't get along. We don't see eye to eye on religion. He's still my brother. I still pray for him every day. We just don't talk religion together. But I've had extended family turn around and haven't spoken to me in years and years. I pray for them every day. Because one day they'll find out. They may not find out I'm right, but they'll find out he's always been right. And hopefully by the time that it's their day, they will come back. My last thought, just before I say a final prayer. I'm a firm believer. I've put my body through everything that it has gone through. It was me that did it. God had a reason for it to happen, that I got into those circumstances. So I'm a true believer. People say, oh, your body is a temple. Mine has been an amusement park. You have to be this high to get on this ride, man. It's been a wild ride sometimes. But I know for a fact, on the judgment day, when my time has come, I'm going to slide in sideways in a four-door car. Those doors are going to fall off. The wheels are going to go flat. I'm going to roll out, and Jesus Christ is going to look at his Father and say, Father, this is Jeff, the one I told you about. That's why I'm not afraid. That's why if you know that in your heart, you have nothing to fear. If God is with us, who can be against us? On that, I'll end. I'd just like to share a quick little prayer. I'm just going to take my hat off. This is just a statement. We need to keep New York, Northern Minnesota, we need to keep those people in our prayers and our thoughts. I'm not getting into political. Bad things have happened. Bad things are happening. We need to pray for those people. Pray for our entire nation. Pray for our entire nations. Pray for our entire world. We will once again become one nation under God. We will once again become one world under God. Whether it be here, we have eternity. The people of the world will kneel and bow before him. With that, just a quick prayer. Lord, thank you for allowing us to gather this morning and sharing all of the blessings that you've bestowed on our life. And thank you for giving our little Joe and Carla Joe and Lynn the opportunity to come and share their faith and their talents, their God-given talents with you. Please pray and keep these people safe in their travels, whether it be near or far, so we can all once again join together. And please keep the people that have been involved in these terrible incidents safe. Let them know you are with them. Let them know you are the great healer, that you and through you and only through you, all things impossible. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, guys. You guys have a wonderful day. Thank you for letting me stand up here and chat at you for a while. God bless you all.